you all so much for being here with us today. My name is Shannon Buff, and I'm the Director of Secondary Schools for the Newton County School System. And on behalf of Ms. Samantha Fury, the Superintendent of the Newton County School System, and Dr. Craig Lockhart, the Deputy Superintendent for the Newton County School System, I would like to welcome you to the Literacy Days competition for this school year. At this time, we're going to bring our sixth grade poetry recitation students to the stage. Our first student is from Clements Middle School.
My name is Kiara Chi, and I will be reciting The Taste of Freedom by Ronald Birmingham. My old daddy used to tell me about the wars he had to fight. He said, "Don't believe those old movies, 'cause killing ain't no pretty sight." He said, "No one is ever born a hero. We just fight to stay alive. 'Cause when those bullets start to fly in, your only thought is to survive. No matter what people may say, freedom. Freedom don't come free. And I pray that you never have to see the things that I had to see." He said, "Son, the taste of freedom is a taste worth dying for. And that should be the only reason you fight in those darned old wars." He talked about his comrades. "So many now are gone." He said, "I'm a lucky one to see my son full grown. So many young men back then were buried where they fell. You see, son, war ain't no game. It's a living, breathing jail cell. You fight for what you know is right, and they fight for what they believe, while mothers on both sides pray and weep and grieve. And when they get that letter that says their son will not return, they say one last prayer for others. Lord, will they ever learn? I don't think peace will ever be as long as men exist. Freedom is our gift, and we must protect it, no matter how much they persist. God bless America."
Hi, I'll be reciting The Biggest Burp Ever by Ken Nesbitt. The record so far for the world's biggest burp is held by Melinda McNert. It wasn't on purpose, she wasn't to blame. Her tummy just rumbled and out the burp came. Belinda then instantly saw her mistake. The ground began trembling and It busted the window and knocked down the door. Her mother and father both covered their ears. Her brother and sister were nearly in tears. Her puppy looked panicked and yipped as he fled. Her kitten just cowered and covered his head. The cars on the streets began skidding and stopping. The shoppers in the shops started dropping their shopping. The squirrels all burrowed, the birds flew away, the sun disappeared for the rest of the day. As clouds began thundering all around town, the trees toppled over, the buildings fell down. Tornadoes and hurricanes blew through the sky. The rivers flowed backwards, the oceans ran dry, the volcanoes erupted from Perth to Peru, the Grand Canyon widened, Mount Everest grew. The earth started spinning in different direction, and worst of all, I lost my iPhone connection. Belinda was pretty embarrassed, all right, but she's well-mannered and very polite. And that's why she knew it would be all okay when she said excuse me and went on her way.
My name is Sierra Dew, and I will be reciting a poem by Maya Angelou, Caged Bird. A free bird leaps on the back of the wind and floats downstream till the current ends. He dips his wing in the orange sun rays and dares to claim the sky. But a bird that stalks that his narrow cage can seldom see through his bars of rage. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. The caged bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still, and his tune is heard on the distant hill, for the caged bird sings of freedom. The free bird thinks of another breeze, the trade wind soft through the sighing trees, and fat worms waiting on a dawn bright lawn as he names the sky his own. But the caged bird stands on the grave of dreams, his shadow shouts on a nightmare scream. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. The caged bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still, and his tune is heard on the distant hill, for the caged bird sings of freedom.
Hi, I'm Dakia Knights, and I will be reciting Middle Child by Mona Beth Lambert. Middle Child. One is older, one is younger than this little old me. I'm the one in the middle. It's not a great place to be. My older sister's always telling me what I can do. I get all the hand-me-downs, very seldom something new. She wears makeup, stays out late, and drives the family car. My transportation is my bike. I'm not allowed to drive it far. My younger sister can be a pain. She causes trouble, I get the blame. Saturday nights, I sit and moan. My little sister can't stay alone. When two of us are playing, we act silly and have a lot of fun. But three of us together, and it's two against the middle one. Of course, being born the oldest has its own drawback, too. Befuddled parents try setting limits. Unfortunately, our folks haven't a clue. They must adjust to a teenager, boyfriends, cars, and staying out late. By the time I've become a teen, surely they'll have passed this frantic state. Being the youngest has a downside too. She'll be lonely when we leave for college. She'll have no one to give her sound advice, share the wisdom, and textbook knowledge. No one asks me. I didn't have a choice. I enter this world the second of three, and after mulling it over and thinking it through, I finally decided. It's not a bad place to be.
Hello. Hello, my name is Ashawn Willis, and I'll be reciting Winter Complaint by Oge Dinesh. Now, when I have a cold, I am careful with my cold. I consult a physician, I do as I'm told. I muffle off my torso and woolly, woolly garb, and I quaff gray felgans of sodium bicarb. I munch on aspirin, I lunch on water, and I wouldn't dream of uskling anybody's daughter. And to anybody's son, I wouldn't say howdy, for I am a sufferer, magna cum laude. I don't like germs, but I'll keep the germs I got. Will I take the chance of spreading them? Definitely not. I sneeze out the window, I cough up the flu, I live like a hermit, still the germs get through. And because I'm considerate, because I'm wary, I'm treated by my friends like Toy Fit Mary. Now when you have a cold, you're as curious with your cold. You're as clunky as a gangster who had just been paroled. You ignore your physician, you eat steaks and oxtails. You stuff yourself with starches, you drink a lot of cocktails. And you claim that gargling is a time of waste, and you won't take soda for you don't like the taste. And you prowl around parties full of selfishness and greet your time with less aggressiveness. You convert yourself into a deadly missile. You exhale hellos like a steamboat's whistle. You sneeze in the subway, you cough at dances, you let everyone else take their own good chances. You're a bionicle bore, a bacterial blighter, you get more invitations than a gossip writer. Yes, your throat may be foggy, and your eyes are slimy, and your hand is clammy, and your nose is brimmy, but you woo my girls with the heart you jimmy, while I sit here with the cold you gimme.
All right, please join me in welcoming our first 7th grade student to the stage. Our first student is from Clements Middle School.
Hello, my name is Bryce Bragg. Sick, by Shel Silverstein. Sick, I cannot go to school today, said little Peggy Ann McKay. I have the measles, the mumps, a gash, a rash, and purple bumps. My mouth is wet, my throat is dry. I'm going blind in my right eye. My tonsils as big as rocks. I've counted 16 chicken pox, and there's one more, that's 17. And don't you think my face looks green? My leg is cut, my eyes are blue. It might be the asthmatic flu. I cough and sneeze and gasp and choke. I'm sure that my left leg is broke. My hip hurts when I move my chin. My belly button's caving in. My back is wrenched, my ankle sprained, my appendix pain each time it rains. My toes are numb. I have a slither in my thumb. My neck is stiff. My spine is weak. I hardly whisper when I speak. My tongue is filling up my mouth. I think my hair is falling out. My elbow's bent. My spine ain't straight. And my temperature is 108. My brain is shrunk. I cannot hear. There's a hole inside my ear. I have a hangnail and my heart is...
What? What's that? What's that you say?
You say today is Saturday? Goodbye, I'm going out to play.
My name is Matthew Walker. I'm going to be doing "O Captain, My Captain," "O Captain, My Captain" by Walt Whitman. O Captain, my Captain, our fearful trip is done. The ship has weathered every rack. The prize we sought is won. The port is near. The bells I hear. The people all exulting. While follow eyes the steady keel, the vessel grim and daring. But O heart, 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 O the bleeding drops of red. Or on the deck my captain lies, fallen, cold and dead. O captain, my captain, rise up and hear the bells. Rise up, for you the flag is flung, for you the bugle trills. For you bouquets and withered wreaths, for you the shores are crowding. For you they call the swaying mass, their eager faces turning. Here, captain, dear father, this arm beneath your head. It is some dream that on the deck you've fallen, cold and dead. My captain does not answer, his lips are pale and still. My father does not feel my arm. He has no pulse nor will. The ship is anchored safe and sound, its voyage closed and done. From fearful trip, the victor ship comes in with object won. Exult, O shores and ring, O bells, but I, with mournful tread, walk the deck my captain lies, fallen, cold and dead.
My name is Latayla Billingsley, and I'm doing Equality by Maya Angelou. You declare you see me dimly through a glass which will not shine, though I stand before you boldly, trim and rank in marking time. You do own to hear me faintly as a whisper out of range, while my drums beat out the message and the rhythms never change. Equality, and I will be free. Equality, and I will be free. You announce my ways are waiting, that I fly from man to man. But if I'm just a shadow to you, could you ever understand? We have lived a painful history. We know the shameful past. But I keep on marching forward, and you keep on coming last. Take equality, and I will be free. Equality, and I will be free. Take the blinders from your vision, and take the padding from your ears, and confess you've heard me crying, and admit you've seen my tears. Hear the tempo so compelling, hear the blood throb in my veins. Yes, my drums are beating nightly, and the rhythms never change. Equality, and I will be free. Equality, and I will be free.
My name is Jay White, and I'll be reciting the creation. And God stepped out on space, and he looked around and said, I'm lonely. I'll make me a world. And as far as the eye of God could see, darkness covered everything, blacker than 100 midnights, down in the cypress swamp. Then God smiled, and the light broke. Darkness rolled up on one side, and the light still shining bright on the other. And down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world. Then God reached out and took the light in his hand and wrote the light around his hand and set that sun ablazing in the heavens. And the light that was left over from making the sun, he gathered it up in a shining ball and flung it against the darkness, spangling the night with the moon and stars. Spangling the night with the moon and stars.
Then down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world. And God said, "That's good." Then God himself stepped down. The sun was on his right hand, the moon was on his left, the stars were clustered about his head, the earth was under his feet, and where he walked and where he trod, his footsteps hollowed the valleys out and bulged the mountains up. Then he stopped and looked and saw that the earth was hot and barren. So he stepped over to the edge of the world and spread out the seven seas. He batted his eyes and the lightning flashed. He clapped his hands and the thunder rolled. And the waters above the earth came down. The cooling waters came down. The green grass sprouted, the little red flowers blossomed, the pine trees pointed his finger to the sky, the oaks spread out his arms, and the lakes cuddled down in the hollows of the ground, the rivers ran down to the sea, and God said, "That's good." Then God walked around and looked around on everything he had made. He looked at his sun, he looked at his moon, he looked at his little stars, he looked down on his world with all his living things and said, "I'm lonely still." So God sat down on the side of a hill where he could think. By a deep, wide river, he sat down. With his head in his hands, he thought and thought until he thought, "I'll make me a man." Up from the bed of the river, he scooped the clay. And by the bank of the river, he kneeled down. There, the great God Almighty, who lit the sun and fixed it in the sky, who flung the stars to the farthest corner of the night, who rounded the world in the middle of his hands, this great God, like a mammy bending over her baby, kneeled down in the dust, toiling over a lump of clay, so he shaped it in his own image. And then into it, he blew the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen, amen.
Hello, my name is Tia Perry, and I will be reciting Little Red Riding Hood and the Wolf by Roald Dahl. As soon as Wolf began to feel that he would like a decent meal, he went and knocked on Grandma's door. When Grandma opened it, she saw the sharp white teeth, the horror again. And Wolf, he said, "May I come in?" But Grandmama was terrified. "He's going to eat me up," she cried. And she was absolutely right. He ate her up in one big bite. But Grandmama was small and tough. And Wolfie, well, that's not enough. I haven't yet begun to feel that I have had a decent meal. He ran around the kitchen yelping, "I've got to have a second helping." Then added with a frightful leer, "I'm therefore going to wait right here till little Miss Red Riding Hood comes home from walking in the wood." He quickly put on Grandma's clothes. Of course he hadn't eaten those. He dressed himself in coat and hat. He put on shoes. And after that, he even brushed and cut his hair, then sat himself in Grandma's chair. In came the little girl in red. She stopped, she stared, and then she said, "What great big ears you have, Grandma." "All the better to hear," the wolf replied. "What great big eyes you have, Grandma," said Little Red Riding Hood. "All the better to see," the wolf replied. He sat there watching her and smiled. He thought, "I'm going to eat this child. Compared with her old Grandmama, she's going to taste like caviar." Then Little Red Riding Hood said, "But Grandma, what a lovely great big furry coat you have on." "That's wrong," cried Wolf. "Have you forgot to tell me what big teeth I've got?" "Ah, well, no matter what you say, I'm going to eat you anyway." The small girl smiles when eyelid flickers. She whips a pistol from her knickers. She aims it at the creature's head and bang, 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 she shoots him dead. A few weeks later, in the wood, I came across Miss Riding Hood. But what a change! No cocoa thread, no silly hood upon her head. She said, "Hello, and do please note my lovely furry
wolfskin coat.
I have been acquainted with the night. I have walked out in rain and back in rain. I have outwalked the furthest city light. I have looked down the saddest city lane. I have passed by the watchman on his beat and dropped my eyes, unwilling to explain. Not to call me back or say goodbye. Not to call me back or say goodbye. Further still at an unearthly height, one luminary clock against the sky proclaimed the time was neither wrong nor right. I have been acquainted with the night.
Hi, my name is Jada Harrison, and I'll be reciting the poem Assurance by William Stanford. You will never be alone. You hear so deep a sound when autumn comes. Yellow pulls across the hills and thrums, or the silence after lightning before it says its names. And then the clouds, wide mouth apologies. You are aimed from birth, you will never be alone. Rain will come, a gutter filled, an Amazon, long aisles. You never heard so deep a sound, moss on rock, in years. You turn your head, that's what the silence meant. You're not alone, the whole wide world pours down. Thank you.
I'm Ivy McWaters, and I'm reciting Jesus is by Clayton Jennings. He is more than you could ever need. He is more than the eye could see. I didn't deserve his love, but he's always been there for me. You see, Jesus met me when I was at my lowest. And if you don't know Jesus, know this. He is the greatest example of generosity this world of greed has ever seen. And when Jesus hit the scene, he changed the scenery and met diversity with serenity. If you're looking for peace, he offers plenty. Jesus was and forever be king. And when the angels sing, they sing with grace still displayed for sinners like me. I can't explain him, and I can't describe him. And if you could, he wouldn't be Jesus, because you can't explain eternity. You can't comprehend the galaxies, but it was the loving hands of Jesus who spun them into existence and creating man, knowing how to go to the cross to pay our sentence. There's a certificate of judgment with the period after the sentence. We are sentenced to death long before he said it was finished. He is a father to the orphans, a shelter for the homeless, hiding place to abuse, and an anchor for our storms. He stormed the gates of hell and came out on top, and the power of his gospel cannot be stopped. Evil in the world tries, and they try a lot. He traded price Barabbas and came the catalyst of missions across the world, covering every portion of the atlas. If you're in need of rest, I know of a mattress. If you don't know Jesus, your future is tragic. But he gladly embraced tragedy so we live in his presence of majesties. His presence is presence. In his presence, he presents preciousness to a world of peasants. He is far from contentious, but still loves those who are. He is light of the world and hung of the stars. He brings the dead to life and delivers lives to the dead. He took a crown of thorns on his head, so he put crowns at his feet. And I can't wait until I can get to kiss his feet that were nailed to a cross for me and for you and for every person around the world. He loves the world, and I love his word, because the word became flesh, and in his flesh he demonstrated the word to the world. He's a sample to every boy and every girl. He's a lover of black people. He's a lover of white people. He's a lover of the unchurched and simply other disciple. He doesn't see the bravest failures, but takes time to celebrate the faithfulness. It's the power of the Spirit that enables us to give us boldness when the world labels us. And if you don't label me, please call me a Jesus freak. And if that freaks you out, good. But because it's better to be good with God than to fight being misunderstood by a world that can never understand. So let it be understood that I don't worship man. We worship Jesus. Even though he doesn't need us, he still sees us to run to the cross for your blood for us. His heart bleeds for us. His heart grieves for us. But still graciously grants us a pardon for our treason in a season where the world tries to explain the work of the Spirit with human reasoning. There's a reason they can't. Because the Spirit is like the wind, and the wind cannot be seen. But love is the one who believes without seeing the unseen. I'm telling you today, Jesus is something. He's something more. He's something great. And if you want to know him, you don't have to wait. He stands the narrow path, the key to the gate, and you only have to reach out and embrace his grace. I don't care who's president. I have a king who's always present. I don't care who holds musical celebrity. The voice of the Lord will always be the sweetest melody. I don't care who holds the riches of the globe. My Jesus holds more wealth than one ruby on his robe. I don't care who's the strongest or the fastest. Nothing matches the creator's of the universe and his immortal infinite status. I don't care about religious leaders who died and stayed dead. I only worship one who conquered death and wears a crown on his head. His name is Jesus, and I'm telling you, he is something. He was faithful yesterday, he is faithful today. I can feel his presence whenever I pray. So when the time comes for me to fade away, I remember the day I heard him say, "My name is Jesus." Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Julian Crockett. My poem is entitled Wolves by Joseph Capehart. My family used to call me big-headed boy. Too smart for his own good, they said my brain was getting bigger. Taking my skull on a ride that my body will have to catch up to later. My grandma said, "Don't grow up too fast. There's plenty of time to join this war." I knew nothing of war. I learned how to fight when I was 9. My brother taught me that my fist could dig a well, and I would die of thirst if I ever stopped swinging. People became obstacles. Weakness, intolerable. Soundproof the walls of your heart, they said. Don't let anyone hear how loud it's beating when you lock eyes with the moon. This is how you survive. I fell in love when I was 12. With a kind voice and multicolored barrettes. I don't remember her name. The name that her father whispered into her mother's belly long before I came along. My cousins had called her body. Call her clothing, he said, call her dog. Call her anything your insecurities can sink their teeth into. Don't grow up too fast, he said, you'll know nothing of love. This is how you survive. I began running up steps 2 and 3 at a time, trying to get to manhood a little bit faster. You see, my father was a pastor who didn't teach me that being a man meant fearing God, but being a man meant being God. And being God meant fearing nothing, that each shed tear put me further away from the man I was supposed to be, forgetting that it was the moment that I cried for the first time, that anyone even knew that I was breathing, and this is my inheritance. The struggle between the need to be loved and the want to be worshiped. My mother taught me that Jesus was a carpenter. So I began building my throne of masculinity on the corpses of everything that made me human. They said, this is how you survive. This is how you win the game. Thinking that they're giving me some head start in adjusting to our society. But what's the use of being well adjusted to something that's broken? Masculinity is getting more and more expensive. They said, in order to become a man, I had to abandon the boy. That I had to sacrifice my humanity, so I wouldn't lose my inheritance. But I learned after my mistakes. I learned when you take away fear, take away love, take away emotion, you don't get to God, you get something less than human. This is not how you survive. These are not lessons for the living. This is how you read the dead. This is how you sharpen teeth, raising boys to find the world has something for our consumption that we should never give up until the no sound like yeses. This is how you raise boys to strip the label of human, who we don't deem worthy. This is how you raise boys to believe this is all okay. It is not okay. I learned how to fight when I was 9. And I still haven't stopped swinging because the road from wolf to human is a fight. A fight of unlearning, of peeling back the layers, of coming to terms with privilege, and biting my tongue and trying not to howl at the moon. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Erlyn Everett, and the poem that I will be reciting is Television by Roald Dahl. The most important thing we've learned, so far as children are concerned, is never, never, never let them near your television set. Or better still, just don't install the idiotic thing at all. In almost every house we've been, we've watched them gaping at the screen. They loll and slop and lounge about and stare until their eyes pop out. Last week, in someone's place, we saw a dozen eyeballs on the floor. They sit and stare and stare and sit until they're hypnotized by it, until they're absolutely drunk with all that shocking, ghastly junk.
Oh, yes. We know what keeps them still. They won't climb out the windowsill. They never fight or kick or punch. They leave you free to cook the lunch and wash the dishes and the sink. But did you ever stop to think, to wonder just exactly what this does to your beloved tot? It rots the sense in the head. It kills imagination dead. It clogs and clutters up the mind. It makes a child so dull and blind. He can no longer understand a fantasy, a fairyland. His bearing becomes as soft as cheese. His powers of thinking rust and freeze. He cannot think, he only sees. All right, you'll cry. All right, you'll say. But if we take the set away, what shall we do to entertain our darling children? Please explain. We'll answer this by asking you, what used the darling ones used to do? How used they keep themselves contented before this monster was invented? Have you forgotten? Don't you know? We'll say it very loud and slow. They used to read. They'd read and read and read and read, and then proceed to read some more. Great Scott, gazooks, when half their lives are spent reading books. The nursery shelves have books galore, books cluttered up the nursery floor. And in the bedroom, by the bed, more books are waiting to be read. Such wondrous, fine, fantastic tales of dragons, gypsies, queens, and whales. And treasure isles and distant shores where smugglers rode with muffled oars. And pirates wearing purple pants and sailing ships and elephants. And cannibals crouching round the pot, stirring away as something hot. It smells so good. What can it be? Good gracious, it's Penelope! The younger ones had Beatrix Potter with Mr. Todd, the dirty rotter, and Squirrel Nutkin and Big Link Bland, and Miss Tinkleweekle, and just how the camel got his hump, and how the monkey lost his rump. And Mr. Toad, and bless my soul, there's Mr. Rat and Mr. Mole. Oh, books, what books they used to know, those children living long ago. So please, oh please, we beg, we pray, go throw your TV set away. And in its place, you can install a lovely bookshelf on the wall and fill the shelves with lots of looks, a box of books, ignoring all the dirty looks. And screams and yells and bites and kicks and children hitting you with sticks. Fear not, because we promise you that in about a week or two of having nothing else to do, they'll now begin to feel the need of having something to read. And once they start, oh boy, you watch the slowly growing joy that fills their hearts. They'll grow so keen, they'll wonder what they've ever seen in that ridiculous machine. That nauseating, foul, unclean, repulsive television screen. And later, each and every kid will love you more for what you did.
Good morning, my name is Zoe Mayo and I will be reciting In the Morning by Paul Laurence Dunbar. Lies, lies, bless the Lord, don't you know the day's abroad? If you don't get up, you scamp, there'll be trouble in this camp. Think I'm grown, let you sleep while I meeks your board and keep? That's a putty howdy do, don't you hear me? Lies, you. Bet if I come across this floor, you won't find no time to snore. They are all a shining in while you sleep. Why, it's a sin. Ain't the candlelight enough to burn out without a snap? But you go the morning through, burn up the daylight too. Lies, don't you hear me when I call? No use turning to those walls. I can hear that matches squeak. Don't you hear me when I speak? This here clock done struck off six. Caroline, bring me down my sticks. Oh, you down, Sahar? You down? Look here, don't you dare frown. Munch yourself and wash your face. Don't you splatter all the place. I got something else to do. Size, just clean up after you. Take that comb off, fix your head. Looks just like a feather bird. Look here, boy, I'll let you see you shouldn't roll your eyes at me. Sit down at that table there, just you whimper if you dare. Every morning on this place seems like I must lose my grace. Fold your hands and bow your head. Wait until the blessing's said. Lord, have mercy on our souls. Don't you dare touch them rolls. Bless the fool, we gonna eat. You sit still, I see your feet. Just you try that trick again. Give us peace and joy. Amen.
We are now going to begin the drama portion of our program. I would like to welcome the Clements team to the stage.
Hey, Mom. I was thinking, does Auntie Candom have to come over? I mean, I love them and all, but Victor, I told you this already, and I'm going to tell you one more time. Of course they're coming, they're family, and don't come around and talk nonsense. Now, if you want some work, you can wash the counters or go upstairs.
Ding dong.
Hey, Mom, I'll go get the door.
Hey, okay.
Hey, Mrs. and Mark Kelly, y'all come on in.
Hey, sis. Where have you been all these years?
In the house.
Wait. These kids, they are paying my mind, I swear.
I just sent one to the room.
I'm so glad we come together for Thanksgiving.
Glad to see you. Hope you have fun.
Ding dong.
I'll get it.
What's up,
Mom? What's up?
Hey, hey! What up, family? What a party!
Oh, great. Crazy office here.
Oh, honey. She has been this white meat beating. They have no respect for elders.
Oh, Lord. The party's about to get ahead.
Ding dong.
Hey, my angel face. I see you gotten taller. I brought candy for everybody.
Grandma, you need to clean your glasses because Angel Face didn't do an inch.
Shut up, retard. You sounded like I'm a math class.
Okay, everybody, let's go eat.
Thank you.
appreciate that.
Once upon a time, there was a king and a queen. They had a baby named Aurora, and they were having a christening for the beautiful baby, but Maleficent was not invited. So Aurora went home to tell the fairies about the man she had just met.
I met a handsome man out in the forest, and I think I'm in love.
Oh no.
Well, it's not totally true. What are you talking about? What is this you speak of?
And so the fairies told Aurora the truth, and then went to the palace and locked Aurora in her room for her own safety.
I see a mysterious light.
And she pricked her finger on the spindle of the spinning wheel and fell to a sleep like death. And so the fairies put everybody in the palace asleep. Meanwhile, the prince was looking for Aurora.
Shoulder. It was around 11 o'clock at night, and she was by herself,
and she had nothing to protect her but her bare hands.
Get up! Get up! Get up! Pick up my pocketbook and give it here.
Now ain't you ashamed of yourself?
Yes, ma'am.
What'd you do it for?
I didn't aim to.
You a lie. If I turn you loose, will you run?
Yes, ma'am.
Then I won't turn you loose.
I'm sorry, lady. I'm sorry.
And your face is dirty, too. I got a hand on my face for you. Ain't nobody at home telling you about your face.
No.
Then I'm gonna watch the TV. You ought to be my son. I will teach you right now. At least I can do now. I'm gonna play for you. Are you hungry?
No, I just want you to turn me loose.
Was that bothering me when I turned my corner?
No.
But you put yourself in contact with me, and you think contact isn't going to last long, you got another big one. When I get through with you, sir, you are going to remember Mrs. Luella Grace Washington.
Jerked him in front of her and dragged him up the street. When they got to the house, they went into a hallway leading to a large kitchenette furnished room.
What's your name, son?
Rogers.
Dear Rogers, go to that sink and wash your face. Let the water get warm. Let the water get running till it's warm. Here's a clean towel. Some blue sweatshirts, and next time, don't think about washing only my purse nor nobody else's.
Thank you, ma'am. So, this day forward, Roger and Mrs. Luella Bates Washington Jones have remembered this day, and for Roger, he's been taught his lesson.
Performing Fight Over Fuchsia, Cousins Middle School.
Thank you. I can't complain.
Yes?
Yes?
Did you say something?
Did you have something to say?
No, did you?
Did you?
Are you enjoying the sale?
Yes, it is an excellent sale. Don't you agree?
Yes, I'm finding many markdown items.
Really? Many markdown items is a good thing?
Good things are good.
Many good things. Many things. Many things happen at a sale like this. Many, many things. Good and bad.
I must agree.
Oh, do you?
Yes, many, many things.
Well, I must say, if I were to say something, I'm quite surprised to see you at the sale.
Oh?
Considering what happened last year at the sale.
Huh, well, I'm equally surprised at your presence.
At the sale.
Considering.
Considering what?
You know what.
Oh, yeah? Why would that be, Kara Sue? I can't think of one single solitary reason why you would be surprised to see me at the sale. I have nothing to be embarrassed about and nothing to apologize for.
Oh, no?
I did nothing wrong like some people.
Who some people?
You know who some people are.
I don't know nothing about any some people.
Oh, yes, you do.
You stole my top.
I saw it first.
I called dibs.
You stomped on my foot.
You broke the pact.
You attacked me.
You deserved it.
You look horrible in fuchsia.
Sure me. Sure me.
Well, it's true.
Sure me.
It makes your face funky. Sorry.
I can't believe you think that.
I'm doing you a favor.
How?
I'm trying to spare your feelings.
You're supposed to be my friend. You're supposed to be friends for life.
Your friend? Your friend? You attacked me over a shirt, Kara Sue.
It's the bargain, little bargain, big bargain sale. The most important fair of the whole year. The only event that matters my whole life.
A sale? A stupid sale?
Don't you belittle the bargain, little bargain, big bargain sale.
It was a stupid top.
That top was going to make Jimmy Joe ask me to the prom.
He would have never asked you, top or no top.
Sure me.
Dang.
Sure me. I can't believe you said that.
It was a stupid talk. It was a stupid fight. Don't you think so, Kara Sue?
I guess.
Do you really?
Do you?
Do you?
Stupid fight.
Can we agree on that?
Yes.
So, if you would just apologize.
Why not you? You go first.
You first.
We can be friends again if you apologize.
You go first and I'll be friends for life.
You.
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 Never.
Fine.
Right. I've got to go.
Yes.
I'll go. Enjoy the sale.
Thank you.
Kara Sue?
Yes?
It may rain this afternoon.
It might.
It might.
Charlene?
Uh-huh.
Make sure you cover your hair if it rains. Your quizzes. Okay.
It does. Thanks. I will.
Please join me in welcoming the Newton County Theme School performing Alice.
Good afternoon. We are representing Newton County Theme School and we're presenting Alice, a one-act adaptation of the famous novel by Lewis Carroll, Alice in Wonderland. Alice follows a white rabbit down the rabbit hole into Wonderland, where she meets a cornucopia of strange creatures. A caterpillar gives her advice, the Mad Hatter and March Hare are always at tea time, and the Queen of Hearts continuously cries off of her head. The Cheshire Cat has everyone in the Wonderland's mad, and therefore Alice must be too. Has Alice lost her mind?
I mean what I say, and that's the same thing, you know.
Not the same thing a bit.
You might as well say that I see what I eat is the same thing as I eat what I see.
You might as well say that I like what I get is the same thing as I get what I like.
You might just as well say I breathe when I see
is
the same thing I see when I breathe.
It is the same thing with you. What day of the month is it?
The fourth.
2 days long. I told you, butter, what it do this works.
It was the best butter.
Yes, so crumb was mine as well. You shouldn't have put it in with the bread knife.
It was the best butter, you know.
What a funny watch. It tells the day of the month and doesn't tell what o'clock it is.
Why should it? Does your watch tell you what year it is?
Of course not. But that's because it stays the same year to year for such a long time together.
Which is exactly the case with mine.
I don't quite understand you.
The doormat is the same again.
Of course. Guess what I was going to remark myself.
Have you guessed it really yet?
No, I thought, what's the answer?
I haven't the slightest idea.
Nor I. I think you might do something better with the time than wasting it asking riddles that have no answers.
If you knew time as well as I do, you wouldn't talk about wasting it. Is it him?
I don't know what you mean.
Of course you don't. I dare say you never even spoke the time.
Perhaps not, but I know how to beat time and I learned music.
That accounts for it. He won't stand beating. Now if you only come on good terms with him, he can want almost anything you like. For instance, suppose it was 9 o'clock, just time to get lessons. You only have to whisper, hit the time and run around the clock in a twinkling. 1:30, time for dinner.
I only wish it was. That would be grand, certainly, but I shouldn't be hungry for it, you know?
Not at first, perhaps, but then you can keep it at 1:30 for as long as you like.
Is that how you manage?
Not I. You quarreled last March. Just before he went mad, you know. It was at the great concert given by the Queen, and I had to sing, twinkle, twinkle, little man, how I wonder what you're at. You know the song, perhaps?
I heard something like it.
It goes on, you know, in this way. Up above the morning sky, I can see you in the sky too.
Twinkle, 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 twinkle.
But I hardly did the first verse. Will the Queen jump up and ball out? She's murdering her time. Up there.
How dreadfully savage.
And ever since that, he will do a thing I ask. It's always 6 o'clock now. My, look at the time. We're almost late for your child. And remember, someone ate the top.
Twinkle, twinkle, little bat, how I wonder what you're at. Twinkle,
twinkle, little bat, how I wonder what you're at.
Harold, read the accusation.
The Queen of Hearts made some tarts on a summer day. The Knave of Hearts stole those tarts and took them quite away.
Consider your verdict.
Not yet. There's a great deal to come before that.
Oh, of course, what is?
I beg pardon, Your Majesty, for bringing these in, but I hadn't quite finished my tea for while I was sitting for.
You ought to have finished. When did you begin?
14th of March, I think it was.
15th.
16th.
Write that down. Take off your hat.
It isn't mine.
Stolen.
I keep them myself. I've done my own. I'm a hatter.
Give y'all. If it isn't known, you know, so I'll be executed on the spot.
Oh, poor girl, Your Majesty. And I hadn't done my tea. Not above a week or so, and what with the bread and butter getting so thin, and the twinkling of the tea.
The twinkling of the what?
It began with the tea.
Of course it would begin with the tea. You take me for a dunce? Go on.
I'm a poor girl, Your Majesty, and most things are twinkled after that. Only the mock has said.
I did it!
I denied it. Leave out that part.
Well, at any rate, the Dormouse said.
Treacle, write that down.
After that, I cut some more bread and butter. I'm a poor girl, Your Majesty.
You are a very poor speaker.
Well, if that's all you know about it, you may stand now.
I can't go, no lore. I'm on the floor as it is.
You may sit now.
I'd rather finish my tea.
Call the next witness.
Call the next witness.
Give your evidence.
Shame.
Well, that's that then.
Your Majesty must cross-examine this witness.
Well, if I must, I must. What are you doing?
Pepper mostly.
Treacle.
Call on that Dormouse. He had that Dormouse. Turn that Dormouse out of this wall. Supreme, pitching, off with his whiskers.
Call the next witness. Really, we must cross-examine this next witness. It quite makes my heart ache.
Well, I am very curious to see who the next witness will be like, for they haven't got much of anything yet.
The next witness is Alice.
Here.
What do you know about this business?
Nothing.
Nothing whatever?
Nothing whatever.
That's very important.
Unimportant, actually. Me, of course.
I meant unimportant, of course. I meant important. Unimportant. Important.
So
Silence. Rule 42 offers more than a mile high must stand at.
I'm not a mile high.
You are.
Nearly 2 miles high.
I shan't go at any rate. Besides, that's not a regular rule. You admitted it just now.
It's the oldest one in the book.
Then it ought to be number one.
Consider your verdict.
Your Majesty, there's a paper that's just been picked up.
What's in it?
It seems to be a letter written from a friend or two to somebody.
It must have been that, unless it was written to nobody, which isn't usual, you know.
It isn't a letter at all. It seems to be a set of verses.
Are they in the prisoner's handwriting?
No, they're not.
He must have imitated somebody else's handwriting.
Please, Your Majesty, I did it right and cannot prove that I did. There's no name signed at the end.
If you didn't sign it, that only makes matters worse. You must have missed a mission, or else you would have signed your name like an honest woman.
Clever, clever, very clever. Oh, she the cleverest thing you ever saw.
That proves her, you. It proves nothing of the sort. Why, you don't even know what they're about.
Read them.
Which one again?
Begin at the beginning and go on till the end, then stop.
They told me you have been to her and mentioned me to him. She gave me the character that said I cannot swim.
Mentioned me to him, said I cannot swim.
She sent them word I have not gone. We know it to be true. If she should push the matter on, what would become of you?
We know it to be true. What would become of you?
I know she was that you had been before she had this fit. An ox cold that can't between him and ourselves in it.
Before she had this fit, him ourselves in it. Him ourselves in it.
That's the most important piece of evidence we forget.
If any one of them can explain it, I don't believe there's an atom of meaning in it.
She doesn't believe there's an atom of meaning in it.
There's no meaning in it. That's in the Lord of trouble, as we need to try to find it. Let the jury consider the verdict.
No, no. Since his first verdict afterwards. Stuff and nonsense. The idea of having sentence first, verdict afterwards.
Hold your tongue.
I won't.
Open your head.
Who cares for you? You're nothing but a pack of cards.
Open your head.
You're nothing but a pack of cards.
Open your head.
It was just a dream after all.
Alice! I'd like to.
Alright, I'm gonna go off the hill.
Performing A True Gentleman, Veterans Memorial Middle School.
Good afternoon. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you all think you're better. Have you ever wanted to see the true ways of the gentleman? Well, you sure are in luck, though, are you?
Today you'll be seeing too many ways.
And I'm going to let them!
I mean, two gentlemen showing off what it means to be true gentlemen. Our first contestant is Edward Fantapine.
Good day, everyone. I'll be participating in this fine demonstration for you all this evening.
I'm not sure if it's evening, but oh, whatever. It's such a kind fellow you are.
And for our next contestant, I present to you Brad Ladd.
Yo, what up, people? You can call me Brad.
Anyway, for the lady of the evening, I present to you Lady Luna. My word, she looks so lovely with her dress on.
You look good! That looks like a dress from Ron John's Surf Shop.
Brad, that's unnecessary.
Whatever, man, you're just not hip and rad like me.
Yo.
I say, such a disgrace. How do you know that, sir? Oh man, don't get your socks in a twist. Amazing deal, Zingo!
Security!
We never hired anyone for guard duty.
No, we invested most of our money, or should I say, we used it as fuel for the chimney fire.
What about the entry fee?
It was used as toilet paper, my uncle, sir.
Money for paid meals?
No, we used to buy homeless people.
Do we at least have any spare donations?
I'm sorry, no, we burned it all in front of the homeless people for entertainment.
Yo, would it be cool to bring my coconuts in front of them?
No.
Well, guys, you act like about to trash this stuff. I ain't doing that till 1 hour later.
Oh,
I'm so exhausted. I'm looking at you with a filthy bunch of people. And after looking at your filthy face, bro,
Zingle!
Now, you don't have to pity poor man.
Oh, I'm not just poor. I'm broke also. get your information correct. Elegancy? Elevator?
Fanciness.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about swag, aka style.
What is this swag you speak of?
Well, dudes, swag is a magical wonder that only appears with your hat on backwards and if your pants are sagging. You also have to have savage skills for sports and hotline blings. You also have to have killer clothes like me and jagged shoes.
Whatever this swag is, it looks like trash compared to elegancy.
That's funny. You should be comedian. Because with the power of swag, we can overcome any obstacle, any challenge, and accomplish anything. Oh, okay. Okay. Well, anyways, I feel like proving the swag versus elegance thing with us with a competition.
If you know what I mean.
Okay. Well, why are we here then, sir?
As just sir. Let's just stop. It will be a best of three from the winner gets to court to the lady.
Go to court? I don't have any money for a lawyer, though.
You mean state? I know already.
I said hush.
Now the first one will be about how to show the fair lady respect. That's a little bit weird. His name comes from the court.
I thought his name was
SILENCE!
Are you ready for this?
Yeah, I'm about to toast your bread though, even though you're all the way backstage.
Okay,
let's just sit down and talk to me, chick. So, how's the weather?
Oh, well, it's lovely beautiful.
Wait! I was not talking about the weather. I was talking about the weather for surfing, because I'm about to get my grind on those gnarly waves.
Okay.
Edward, your turn!
Yes, ma'am. So, how's the weather today?
Or should I
say? No, I'm just kidding. How's the induction ceremony today?
I was very prepared and exclusive. I had a chance to host it every day. I would pass in general.
Must have been a very memorable experience for you.
Oh, yes, a very great experience.
Well, Brad. Judging from the reactions of Lady Luna, it has looked like I have won this round.
How about I make the most clutch comeback ever? Believe it!
I really doubt that.
I doubt that as well. Anyhow, let's start the second round.
It will be a talent contest to see who has the best.
That is going to prove to be very interesting.
Whatever, man. I still bet I'll beat you. In an elephant competition, I think.
For my talent, I can tell the most funniest jokes in history. What do you call a big noodle? An imposter!
You're so humorous. Really.
Periodically. Actually, told one other day, but I got a reaction.
Oh, dude, stop!
Either quiet or entry.
You mean elegant?
You take me, I take mine.
I almost broke my leg when I was driving to get here. I'm so glad I did it, because I'd have to get a cast.
Wow, Edward, that was so great, honestly, truly. But let's give this one a Brad. I mean, you win everything. You're just superb. Let's give this one a Brad. You just did great, right, really.
Everyone knows I'll be superior to him anyway.
Sure. Now, the final round. It will be a singing contest, like X Factor, but that's time and power.
But I'm more of a rapping goal, bro.
I guess rapping is the wrong one.
Video!
heard my rap yet. You ready for this? Mom spaghetti, knees, feet, arms are heavy, the bottom part is sweating spaghetti. Mom spaghetti, he's nervous, while the serving loves con spaghetti, ready to drop bomb. But he keeps on spaghetti when he goes down, the whole crowd goes so loud.
A certificate because not only did you make it this far, but you won your school level award, so you get to be up here on the stage. So everybody gets a certificate and a ribbon. So our first participant who gave us the poetry recitation for the Taste of Freedom was Chiara Chi, and she was from Clements Middle School. Make sure you let her get her picture. Okay. From Indian Creek, we had Lindsay Cole. From Liberty Middle School, Sierra Du. From the Newton County Theme School, Dekiah Knight. Did I say it wrong? Is it Dekiah? Dekiah Knight, I apologize. And from Veterans Memorial Middle School, Ashen Willis. Okay. Our runner-up for the sixth grade competition is Sierra Du. And this year's winner for the sixth grade poetry recitation from the Newton County Theme School, Dekiah Knight. Good job, Dekiah. All right, we'll start with our participation certificates and ribbons. From Clements Middle School, Bryce Bragg. From Cousins Middle School, Matthew Walker. From Indian Creek Middle School, Latalia Billingsley. Latayla, I apologize, Latayla. From Liberty Middle School, Jade White. And from the Newton County Theme School, Tia Perry. This year's seventh grade runner up, from Cousins Middle School, Matthew Walker. Congratulations, Matthew. our winner for 7th grade poetry recitation from the Newton County Theme School, Tia Perry. Let's give all of our 7th graders another round of applause. From Clements Middle School, Sean Briggs. From Cousins Middle School, Jada Harrison. From Indian Creek Middle School, Ivy McWaters. From Liberty Middle School, Julian Crockett. From the Newton County Theme School, Erilyn Everett. And from Veterans Memorial Middle School, Zoe Mayo. This year's 8th grade runner-up is Zoe Mayo. And this year's 8th grade winner from Liberty Middle School, Julian Crockett. Thank you again to our 8th grade participants. The next group of awards we're going to give out are actually to a group of students who you didn't see perform today, but who worked on essays for the Ready Writing competition. And this was a competition where they submitted essays to us prior to today, and so we're going to give out their awards now. From Clements Middle School, Romanita Reyes. Okay, she's not here. From Cousins Middle School, Danita, I can't, how do you say your last name? Lamadou. Thank you for helping me say that. Okay. From Indian Creek, Justice Green. From Liberty Middle School, Amaria Thrasher. From the Newton County Theme School, Jamani Parker. And from Veterans Memorial Middle School, Natalie Henderson. Okay, and for our Ready Writing competition, our runner-up from Indian Creek Middle School is Justice Green. And our Ready Writing 6th grade winner from the Newton County Theme School, Jamani Parker. Congratulations to our 6th grade participants. So from Clements Middle School, Jewel Harper. Okay, Jewel's not here. From Cousins Middle School, Sybil Kroll. From Indian Creek Middle School, Bailey Smith. From Liberty Middle School, Erickson Aday. From the Newton County Theme School, Morgan Fannin. And from Veterans Memorial Middle School, Alicia Cole. Our 7th grade runner-up from Indian Creek Middle School, Bailey Smith. And our winner from the Newton County Theme School, Morgan Fanning. Thank you to our 7th grade participants. Can I please have the 8th grade participants to the stage? I got School, Damari Jones. From Cousins Middle School, Ray Holt. From Indian Creek Middle School, Ateria Mulgrave. From Liberty Middle School, Robert Pierce Thomas. From the Newton County Theme School, Cheyenne Washington. And from Veterans Memorial Middle School, Noreen Gray. Fisher's runner-up is from Veterans Memorial Middle School, Noreen Gray. And our winner sweeping this category from the Newton County Theme School is Cheyenne Washington. For Thanksgiving, the cast members are Heaven Hodges, Tania Banks, Kelsey Harp, Isaiah Thornton, Tyra Hicks, Victor Piggy, Kendall Maddox, Markayla Rowland, Benita Jatta, Benta, Taylor Allen, and Alonzo Cornwell. Let's give Clements one more round of applause. Thank you. From Indian Creek performing Sleeping Beauty, Christian Hogan. Stacy Castillo. Janelle Fuller. Addison Krieger. Ripley Dominguez. Jada Williams. Riley Bristow. And Betty Egan. Thank you, Indian Creek Middle School. All right. performing Thank You, Ma'am from Liberty Middle School, Brenda Lee Qualls. Our Travius Avery. And Tyler Huzzy. Thank you, Liberty Middle School. All right, performing Flight Over Fuchsia, Emma Davenport and Taylor Neely. All right, performing Alice, Abby Norton. Tia Perry. Natalie Hansen. Hannah Scarf. Sydney Lindsay. Michael Flanagan. Molly Deemer. Mark Ross. Gordon Everett. And Milan Parker. Thank you, Newton County Theme School. All right, from Veterans Memorial Middle School, Ify Ojako. Raphael Soraya. Tyler Blake. And Zoe Mayo. Let's give one more round of applause to Veterans Memorial Middle School.
Thank you.
All right, so now we can finally announce the winner. Can I have a drum roll, please? All right, this year's winner of the drama competition, Veterans Memorial Middle School.
Come on.
Congratulations, Veterans Memorial Middle School.
Thank you.
At this time, I want to thank you all once again for participating. I need all of our winners and all of our runners up to please report to the stage so that we can take a picture. Thank you so much. You guys have a great day.